Thanks. Well, it's a pleasure to be here visiting again. I'm going to hope to have the time to talk about two related results. The first is joint work with Hung Bui and Dale Smith, and the second is joint work with Chris Hull, formerly of this parish, and Edva Roditi-Gershon. So these are related results, but they have a slightly different flavour, so I'll try to make clear as we go along. So I think, as the title suggests, what I'm going to be talking about are arithmetic functions and how they fluctuate as measured in terms of by the variance of the fluctuations. And let me give a sort of simple example, basic example of what I want to describe, and this concerns the von Magoldt function. So the function which selects the primes and their powers from the integers in an analytically natural way. So lambda of n is log p if the integer n, the argument here, is a power of some prime p, and it's zero otherwise. So lambda selects the prime powers and weights them by the log of the prime involved, irrespective of the power. So the prime number theorem tells you about sums of the von Magoldt function over large ranges of the argument n. So if we sum n less than or equal to x, lambda of n, this is equal to x plus a term which is little o of x. So there's a relatively simple average. The average of the von Magoldt function is 1 if you take it over a long range. But in many applications, what you want is not to count primes and their powers over long ranges, but over shorter intervals. In fact, historically, the prime number theorem was inspired by numerical computations at the end of the 18th and early 19th century, first of all by Gauss. And he did exactly what I said. He split the integers up into ranges of length 1,000, a kiliad, and counted how many primes there were in each kiliad, and then averaged over those different kiliads, and came up with a guess that's consistent with this one, essentially equivalent to this one, and this was later proved to be correct. But Gauss himself recognized that if you count the primes in different kiliads, ranges length of 1,000 integers, you see large fluctuations. It was those fluctuations that he averaged away by including a large number of intervals. But he raised the question as to what the fluctuations were. So if we denote this function psi of x, he was asking about psi of x plus h minus psi of x minus h, which is the, so this is counting the number of primes and their powers in a range between x and x plus h. You expect from the prime number theorem the average to be h. And his question was, how does this quantity fluctuate? And here in his computations, h would be 1,000. But in general, what one's interested in is x growing, h being small compared to x, but itself growing as well. So one way to measure that is in terms of the variance, which would be psi, this quantity, squared, integrated from, say, 1 to capital X dx. So that would give the measure of the size of the fluctuations. And there's a conjecture due to Goldston and Montgomery, but later elaborated by Montgomery and Soundararajan, for how this variance should behave. And their conjecture is the following: integral from 1 to capital X psi x plus h minus psi of x minus h dx, they claim should behave asymptotically like x, that's the length of the interval over which one's integrating here, so that basically says that the average exists as x tends to infinity, times h, which is the saying that the variance, the mean of this quantity, of this difference, is of size h, and the assertion is asymptotically that the variance is of the order of the mean, which is what you'd expect if the primes and the powers were Poisson distributed, but with a correction term, which looks as follows: it's log x minus log h minus a constant, which I'll write in a different color, twice the Euler constant. Sorry, it's the Euler constant plus log 2 pi.
Now, how big is h compared to
k? Right, I'm about to say, so this is meant to be true uniformly for h between x to the epsilon and x to the 1 minus epsilon for any epsilon. So the history of this is that the original conjecture was the bits part written in white, and that was due to Goldston and Montgomery, and this was a lower order term, if you like. So we're thinking of x growing and h growing, so these terms dominate this constant term, but the constant term was added by Montgomery and Sound. And the idea is that this should be true now up to some power saving. So the error term implicit in this asymptotic notation should grow like a smaller power of x than the first. So this isn't a series expansion in powers of 1 over log x, for example. This term here stops. This is a polynomial in log x and log h. And then the correction terms, the error term, should be smaller powers of x and h. So where does this come from, this conjecture? Well, I'll tell you first of all about the Montgomery Soundararajan computation, which historically was the second, but I think it's a little easier to see what's going on in that. Montgomery and Sound based their computations on the Hardy-Littlewood conjecture. Which concerns the pair correlation of the prime numbers. So if we get the von Magoldt function and multiply it by itself, shifted by some integer k, and sum this n less than or equal to x, then the Hardy-Littlewood conjecture is that this is asymptotic to x. It grows like x. There is some average behavior of this correlation function multiplied by some arithmetic function of k. And that's usually called the singular series. And sigma of k is the following function. It's twice the product of all odd primes, or minus 1 over p minus 1 squared. So that's a constant. And then there's a term that depends on k. It's a product of odd primes, which divide k. Q minus 1 over Q minus 2, and that's the case if K is even. And if K is odd, it's 0. So this is a conjecture, goes back to 1923, Hardy and Little, as I say, which tells you how to count the number of prime pairs, if you like, twin primes. So it's counting how many primes, if K equals 2, it's telling you how many primes there are where n and n plus 2. Are both prime. So it's not difficult to see that if you want to compute this variance, remember psi is a sum of the von Magoldt function, a sum of the lambdas, and we're squaring it. So it's not difficult to see that the left-hand side is a sum of pairs of integers, n and m, with the von Magoldt function evaluated at both n and m multiplied together. So it's not difficult to see that terms like this will appear. And what... Right, so they made an explicit assumption that it was in some sense, in a technical sense, benign, didn't grow too quickly. And then what they were able to establish was that, so the theorem is that if we call this formula GM and this Hardy-Littlewood conjecture HL, the theorem is that the Hardy-Littlewood conjecture, with an assumption that the error term is benign,
even for k large,
yeah. This implies the conjecture GM with this constant term here, the Euler constant plus log 2 pi. And in fact, they showed that if the error term really is benign, this is true with a power saving. So the error terms here, they gave an explicit expression for the error term. I won't write it down, but it's a smaller power than the first in x. So that's the origin of this, or how it's related to the Hardy-Littlewood conjecture. The original Goldston-Montgomery argument was slightly different. There's an explicit formula which connects the primes to the zeros of the Riemann zeta function. And that's not difficult to see if you look at the Dirichlet series for zeta prime over zeta of s. That's just minus the sum of integers n, lambda n over n to the s. So it's not difficult to imagine that if you want to compute variances of sums of the von Magoldt function, you can do that analytically by analyzing the behavior of zeta prime over zeta. And this has singularities at the pole of the zeta function at s equals 1, but also critically at the zeros of the zeta function. And in fact, the non-trivial zeros of the zeta function are what really determine the behavior of this variance. And so Goldston and Montgomery analyzed the problem in that way. In particular, they analyzed a function which had earlier been introduced by Montgomery, f of x and t, which is, if we denote the zeros, the non-trivial zeros of zeta of s by a half plus I gamma. And just for ease of presentation, we'll assume the Riemann hypothesis. So these numbers gamma are real. Then Montgomery had earlier studied sums of the following form. Some pairs of zeros of the zeta function between 0 and some capital T of x to the I gamma minus gamma prime times some smooth weight function, w of gamma minus gamma prime, where, to be explicit, the weight function that Montgomery used is 4 over 4 plus u squared. That's not precise form of this weight function, isn't important. You just want a function which ensures the convergence of this sum and which keeps gamma and gamma prime relatively close to each other, which decays as a function of its argument. So Montgomery had analyzed this sum of pairs of Riemann zeros. And what he'd found was that there's a theorem of Montgomery that if we take x between, say, t to the a1 and t to the a2, then uniformly, if A1 is greater than 0, less than or equal to A2, less than 1, then f of x and t is asymptotic to 1 over 2 pi times t log x. And in the second regime, if A1 less than or equal to A2 greater than 1, then f is asymptotic to t over 2 pi log t over 2 pi, log t. There are two regimes. This regime, this is a theorem, and this regime is a conjecture. It's the Montgomery conjecture. So the idea of the conjecture is that if we plot f against log x, the behavior is linear for x less than about t, and then there's a saturation, and the function's an even function. And the reason this, of course, is of some interest is that this is the Fourier transform of the pair correlation of eigenvalues of random complex emission matrices, the so-called Gaussian unitary ensemble of random matrices. Or if you like, it's the Fourier transform of the pair correlation function of eigenvalues of random unitary matrices. So this is the sort of Montgomery conjecture. There's a sort of bit that's the theorem, and then there is the conjecture in this range where you have this saturation. And what Goldston and Montgomery proved, so if we call this the asymptotic behavior M for Montgomery, and Goldston and Montgomery proved the following theorem. That essentially M, the Montgomery conjecture, is equivalent to the Goldston-Montgomery conjecture for variance of the sum of primes in short intervals, but you don't get the constant term. So GM minus the constant term. So the origin of the constant term is a little mysterious in this way of calculating. You just get the leading order asymptotics, but from the Montgomery conjecture, you can't recover this lower order term. It's the only lower order term that exists. As I say, the rest, the error term is a power down compared to the leading order. Now, I'll just make a sort of parenthetical remark. There's a slightly different way to do this analysis. So clearly, the von Magoldt function is related to a ratio of zeta functions, zeta prime over zeta. So the variance of sums of the von Magoldt function, that's the square of sums like this, is related to a ratio of products of zeta functions with two on the top and two on the bottom. And there is something called the ratio conjecture, which is due to Conry, Farmer, and Zinnbauer, which is heavily based or inspired by calculations in random matrix theory concerning ratios of spectral determinants of random matrices. But it concerns integrals of the following form, integral 0 to t, zeta of a half plus alpha plus it, zeta of a half plus beta minus it, divided by zeta of a half plus gamma plus it is equal to a half plus delta minus it. So the ratio conjecture is a conjecture for the asymptotics of integrals of this form. And you can see that you can go from here to here straightforwardly by, for example, differentiating with respect to alpha and beta, and then setting alpha equal to gamma and beta equal to delta. And you recover via that route the Montgomery conjecture. So it's another way of getting the Montgomery conjecture post, sort of anti-chronologically, because the Montgomery conjecture came first, but the ratio conjecture implies the Montgomery conjecture. So you could take that as your starting point. So I'll just mention that one reason why we, and this comment may appear a little strange and disconnected at the moment, but I'll make the connection relevant a little later. There's one reason why we might believe this sort of conjecture. At the moment, all I'm saying is that this conjecture is related to several other conjectures. It's related to the Hardy-Littlewood conjecture, it's related to the Montgomery conjecture, and it's related to the ratio conjecture. But there's one reason why you might believe it, and this is that in function fields, so this is another parenthetical remark, the analog of GM is true unconditionally. This is something that proved with Zev Rednick of years ago. So I'll just mention mention this briefly. It's not really the thing I want to concentrate on right now in the talk, but to make the connection while the notation's on the board. In function fields, one's analyzing not integers, but polynomials f defined with a finite field of q elements, so whose coefficients say integers modulo q, q is a prime. And these play the role of the integers, and there are objects that play the role of the primes. So the role of the primes in this setting are played by the monic irreducible polynomials, positive primes. So one can analyze the fluctuations in the distribution of monic irreducible polynomials amongst all monic polynomials of a given degree. And that can be calculated, it turns out, because first of all, in this setting, we know the Riemann hypothesis. There is a spectral interpretation, if you like, for the zeros of the zeta function in this case. We know that. Pardon? I'm not saying
spectral
it's.
Spectral interpretation does not.
That's true, but there is a spectral interpretation. There are matrices.
Thank you.
Sorry?
He's going to use something else.
I'm going to use something else. So I'm going to use the fact that the zeros can be written as the eigenvalues of matrices, elements of some conjugacy class. And in this case, right. In this case, there is the matrices that appear here do equidistribute. There is some, one can prove the analog of the Montgomery conjecture in the limit as Q tends to infinity. So the matrices whose eigenvalues are the zeros of the zeta functions equidistribute in some group, which in this case, happens to be the unitary group, and this was proved by Nick Katz relatively recently, and using the sort of Katz equidistribution formula, one can establish the exact analog of this Goldston-Montgomery conjecture. So it's one reason what you might believe, why you might believe this conjecture to be true in this sort of full range where it's conjecture. Okay, so that's the background. Now what are we actually, where does this go? So the first thing I want to tell you is a generalization of this story. This story is very particular to the Riemann zeta function. We're looking at the fluctuations of an arithmetic function, psi, the sum of the von Magoldt function, and the von Magoldt function appears as the Dirichlet coefficients, the logarithmic derivative of the zeta function. So this sort of story is related to zeta, and that's why the zeros of the Riemann zeta function appear in this kind of Montgomery formalism. So I want to tell you about the generalization of this to other L functions. And this is the first sort of story I want to tell, and this is the work that's that was done with Bowie and Smith. So the idea is we want to take some L function. So we'll let L be some primitive L function. And actually what I'm going to state are some general formulae that apply to sort of any primitive L function taken from the Selberg class. So it's a rather general sort of generalization that I want to examine. So this L function will have a Dirichlet series. I'll write in the following way. So in the case of the Riemann zeta function, A is just 1. In the case of the Dirichlet L functions, these would just be characters. In the case of elliptic curve L functions, these would be Fourier coefficients of some related modular form. In the case of the Ramanujan L function, this would be the Ramanujan tau function, etc. So there's a rather general class of L functions I want to consider. So I want to denote this L function. It has an Euler product. And I want to denote this in the following. It's a product of primes P, E to some sum, J is 1 to infinity, B, L, P to the J, divided by P to the J, S. So there is some Euler product for this L function. And from that, you can derive a formula for the logarithmic derivative of the L function. And I'll denote this by the following type of expression. So lambda of L, these are the Dirichlet coefficients of the series expansion for L primed over L. So in the case of the Riemann zeta function, this is just the von Magoldt function. In the other cases, this will be the von Magoldt function multiplied by something that comes from the coefficients BP. So this may be the related to, for example, in the case of the elliptic curves, this will be the von Magoldt function multiplying some coefficients coming from the associated modular form, etc. And what we're going to be interested in are variances of sums of these Dirichlet coefficients, the lambda L's, in short intervals. So we want to mimic this kind of construction and ask what's the formula for the variance in that case. I need a bit more notation before I write that down. I'm going to, this L function, we'll say, has pole of order ML at S equals 1. M could be zero.
It's always zero except for zeta.
It's always zero except for zeta, but yeah, you're quite right. Well, I want zeta to be included in this story, but you'll see. I want zeta to appear here for real. I'm going to recover some formulae that we got earlier in more general form. So yeah, in all cases except for the Riemann zeta function, m will be zero, but it's one in the case of the zeta function. The functional equation we can write in general as saying that if we denote phi of s to be q to the s, the product j is 1 to r gamma of lambda j s plus mu j times L of S. So we have some product of gamma functions, R of them, and the sum factor Q to the S here. Then this, the functional equation, is just that this phi of S is related to phi bar of 1 minus S, the complex conjugate evaluated at 1 minus S, up to some factor epsilon L. And here, modulus of epsilon L is 1. Q is positive, and the lambda j's are positive, and the mu j's have real part, which are positive. Otherwise, there's some arbitrariness in how you write these gamma functions. Yep. So the degree of the L function is then, by definition, twice the sum of the lambdas. And the conductor of the L function, QL, is 2 pi to the power dL times Q squared times the product J is 1 to r lambda j to the power 2 lambda j. So we're going to need d and q. They're going to appear. They're the things that are going to characterize the general formulae I want to write down. These are sort of invariants for the L function. So for the Riemann zeta function, that has degree equal to 1 and conductor equal to 1. The Dirichlet L functions have degree 1 and varying conductors, and the elliptic curve L functions have degree 2, Ramanujan tau, Ramanujan L function has degree 2, etc. So there's can write down something akin to the prime number theorem. Sum n less than or equal to x lambda L of n. And that's just going to be ml times x plus little o of x. And we're going to need the Riemann hypothesis, or the generalized Riemann hypothesis. I want to assume that in the formulae I write. So the generalized Riemann hypothesis is that the non-trivial zeros L, which I'll denote by gamma L, half plus I gamma L, have gamma L all real. So the object we want to calculate are the variance direct generalization of what we did for the Riemann zeta function. What we want to calculate is the variance integral from 1 to capital X, psi L of X plus H minus psi L of x minus ml times h. So we're counting the, we're summing these generalizations of the von Magoldt function in some short interval from x to x plus h. We're subtracting off from the analog of the prime number theorem the expected size of that, and we're looking for the variance in the fluctuations. So the question is, how does one try to calculate that? Well, we have the options on the board. The first option might be to try some generalization of the Hardy-Littlewood conjecture. Well, what you do know is that that's a very bad idea. So you know enough to know it's a very bad idea. Why is that? Well, if you sum lambda L n lambda L n plus k, the expectation is that this is little o of x as x tends to infinity. So there's no analog of this main term in the Hardy-Littlewood formula. Now remember, it's the main term which gives rise to the Goldston-Montgomery formula. So you can go directly to here. And the assertion is that for most L functions, this leading order coefficient is zero. So that might lead you to think that the behavior of this variance is significantly different to the case of the Riemann zeta function. Because, to repeat, the term that gives rise to the variance formula for the Riemann zeta function doesn't exist for these other L functions. So this might lead you to suspect trouble. However, you can also try the approach based on you can exactly, exactly. No, you can do it for Dirichlet, but for the general case, you yeah.
There are correlations with lambda n not canceling at bounds.
Right. Right, but I think that's not enough to get to win you this variance.
Should there be an absolute value there? Yes.
Not necessarily. Ah, right, okay.
Mm-hmm. By looking at sums, what's called Voronoi summation.
Right.
And then you do see this relation. I think it's not the right way to go.
Right, right. No, it's true. This isn't zero. There's clearly some structure here. But it's structure that comes in the sort of terminology of the Sertle method. It's not coming from the major arcs. So it has a different origin. So you could try the Montgomery type approach. So we can look at some function f l of x and t, which is defined to be sums of pairs gamma l prime. Say now, line, these needn't be symmetric, line between minus t and t of x to the I gamma l is gamma l prime w gamma L prime. And here the story looks slightly different because there are a general class of results that say that this function f should actually be rather similar to the Montgomery expression, the random matrix expression. So there's results due to Peter and Zev some years ago, which calculate this for primitive L functions in a certain range. I'll say what their result is. And then there's an obvious extension of that as a conjecture for how F should behave over the whole range. And the sort of idea, which I think now has the name Murti and Pirelli as a sort of, I think, the first people to write this down in certain form, but I think it appeared substantially in a paper of Peter and Zev, that this should be asymptotic to t over pi log x. So this is uniformly for x lying between t to the a1 and t to the a2 with 0 less than a1 less than or equal to a2 less than or equal to the degree dl. And for the rest of the range, this should be dl times t over pi log t. So this is uniformly for x in that range, where a1 is less than or equal to a2, greater than the degree, and less than infinity. So this is the generalization of the Montgomery conjecture, and it sort of follows the principle that for any principal L function, if you look up the critical line, the zero should have a sort of universal form, which is just that given by random complex, the eigenvalues of random complex emission matrices. So this, the sort of Hardy-Littlewood level, things look very different, but at the level of the zeros, things look very similar. And in fact, the degree appears in a rather simple way. So you might expect that the answer you would get for the variance over here should be essentially the same as for the Riemann zeta function, modulo some factor associated with the degree. So we have one answer which says things should be quite different, and the other one says they should be essentially the same. And the question is which one wins out. So let me tell you. First, before doing that, let me tell you of an extension of this conjecture, if you like, which allows us to capture more precise information. So this extension comes from realizing that just as the Montgomery conjecture follows from integrals of this form, so this conjecture follows from averages, similar averages, but where we replace zeta by the appropriate L function in this case. And expressions for those averages, conjectures for those averages, have also been written down by Connery, Farmer, and Zirnbauer, and others. So we can go from conjectures relating to ratios of the L functions we're working with to a conjecture of this form, but we can get a more precise expression for F, for the asymptotics of F. So the ratio conjecture implies a more precise form of the asymptotic, which you say is that FL of X and T should be T over pi log X up to some power saving, see some positive number. So as capital T tends to infinity, we have exactly the term here. And the assertion is there aren't lower order terms in powers of log x, for example. The next term is some power of t down. But in the second regime, we have a slightly more precise formula. It's t over pi times the degree times log t over 2 pi plus the log of the conductor minus the degree, and this is true up to some power saving. So the ratio conjecture implies a slightly more precise asymptotic in this second regime. There's an additional constant term, and then you have your power saving. And this is uniform, as I say, for some c greater than zero. So now one can apply the sort of Montgomery-Goldston argument. So Montgomery-Goldston, Goldston-Montgomery rather, is a sort of Tauberian argument. The idea is that we want to compute this variance. The explicit formula relates psi to a sum of zeros of the L function L. And so this variance turns out to be an integral transform of FL, which is itself a sum of pairs of zeros.
In terms of your old papers with the
Molnar. Yes.
So this is the next term in the pair correlation.
Yes. So we didn't write formulae like this down. You probably could recover them from that paper, but.
To see the log,
yes.
These two new terms.
Right. No, we didn't write things in this way. So I don't know. I actually have thought about that, and I don't quite know how to get it from those. I'm sure one can, but I've not figured out how. But what's nice is you get that the constant term just depends on the conductor and the degree in a rather simple way. So you might expect, given that FL looks very much like its zeta, like for all L, looks very much like the case when L is zeta, this part is exactly the same. This part is the same modulo sum multiplying factor, and then there's a smaller constant in the asymptotic, you might expect things to look very similar. So the theorem I want to sort of tell you about is, so this is the first result, which is due to Bowie, myself, and Dale Smith. Is that just as Goldston-Montgomery gives you an equivalence by analyzing some sort of, let's say, the variance we want is some integral transform of FL, and so one needs to do some Tauberian argument to go from the asymptotics of F to the asymptotics of the variance. Turns out to be slightly delicate, but one can carry that through. And the theorem is that this conjecture here for FL is equivalent to the following, if we get integrate 0 to x modulus it's equivalent to the statement that this variance is asymptotic to hx times dl log x minus dl log h. So this is looking exactly like the case of the zeta function where d equals 1. The degree is just a sort of overall multiplying factor plus a constant, which is the log of the conductor minus gamma, the Euler constant, plus log 2 pi times the degree. And this is uniform in some range.
You're saying this extra term in the pair correlation in the harder range.
Yep.
Explains the rib.
Yes, exactly. It exactly explains that. Yes, so DL is 1 and Q is 1.
And so even for zeta, it's
yes.
A different way of getting it.
Exactly. It matches up with zeta. So this looks very promising. So this is uniform in uniform for H. Greater than x to the 1 minus b2, let's call it, less than x to the 1 minus b1. So this looks exactly like for the Riemann zeta function, for the zeta function case, for the where lambda L really is the von Mangold function. It's exact analog of the Goldston-Montgomery thing. However, this is only true in the range where 0 is less than b1, less than or equal to b2, less than 1 over the degree. Now, for the Riemann zeta function where the degree is 1, that's the whole range. But if the degree is greater than one, we only get the formula that one gets is only a partial answer. Instead, there's a second regime where this looks like 1/6 hx times 6 log x minus 3 plus 8 log 2. And this is true uniformly in the same range, it's h greater than x to the 1 minus b2, less than x to the 1 minus b1, where here 1 over the degree is less than b1, less than or equal to b2, less than 1. So this second regime doesn't exist for degree 1 L functions. So it doesn't exist for the Riemann zeta function, doesn't exist for Dirichlet L functions, but as soon as you go to degree 2 and higher, you get this second regime coming in. And the answer, and as the degree gets large, this is the dominant regime. This covers most of the range. So in fact, this sort of Goldston-Montgomery type formula is true for a shrinking range when the degree gets larger. It's true for these powers b1 and b2 in the range between 0 and 1 over the degree. The second regime is quite interesting because it's completely universal. It only depends on h and x. It doesn't depend on the conductor, and it doesn't depend on the degree. So it's a sort of super universal regime. In the first regime, the conductor and the degree do appear. The degree, in a rather simple way, the leading order asymptotic comes from these two terms, and then the degree is just a multiplying factor. The conductor also appears in the lower order term, the constant term. But here, there's no mention of the degree or the conductor. So one has these two regimes. And as I say, the proof is similar to the Goldston-Montgomery proof, but it has to be slightly more careful. First, because we're trying to get more accurate information from our Tauberian argument. We're trying to get these lower order constant terms. And second, because of these two regimes. But the arguments are similar. It's a straightforward analysis. So I think the challenge is to understand how this can come from any kind of Hardy-Littlewood type approach. Because there, we have no formula that's the analog of this. And yet, remarkably, one gets a similar expression appearing, at least for some of the range, but a new expression appearing as a second range. And I really don't understand how one could hope to get that from, or how that will emerge from some sort of analysis of the minor arcs in some subtle method representation of that correlation function of the lambdas. So
you're using this ratio.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Now, does this ratio, this involves determinants, I guess, right?
Yes, that's right, yeah.
Ratios.
Yeah, exactly.
But are those determinants different for the L functions, the generalized L functions, or are you just using the same determinants?
Using the same determinants, yeah. Using the same determinants. What one has to watch out for is that in these formulae that connect, at the random matrix level, they're the same formulae, but if you build in the arithmetic, they're slightly different. There are arithmetical terms that appear multiplying those determinants that one has to, that account for these. Yeah, exactly. So now, should one believe this kind of calculation? It's based on this sort of conjecture. So there are two reasons, I think, to believe it. The first is it's borne out by numerics. So perhaps we could have a slide, the slides that I wanted to show. If we could have the screen down. I don't believe anything until I see a picture. Sorry? H is relatively large. H is the power of x. H is a power of x. Yeah. So I want h to be relatively large. I don't know what happens when h is 1.
H is 1,
yeah. There's nothing in there. It's, as you say, it's very easy when h is 1. Yes.
I think the formula is similar to the formula in the second range.
Oh, okay.
I don't know. I mean, it's true. I think it's true for function fields. So I think it's also here.
Okay.
So the second range is really like the range.
Okay. Okay, we can talk about that later because I'm going to say what the case is for function fields in a minute. So this is the data for the Riemann zeta function, and what's plotted here is the variance divided by hx. So this is the thing that should be a linear function of log x over h. That's the Goldston Montgomery formula, as with the constant that was calculated by Montgomery and Sound. And this is the line that's the sort of Montgomery Sound, Goldston Montgomery prediction. And the data for the Riemann zeta function you see there. And note that this goes sort of seems to be pretty much described by the straight line over the whole range all the way up to this variable equals about 16. It's as far as we could go. Now, if you look at degree 2 L functions, the data looks somewhat different. So these are two degree 2 L functions. This is the Ramanujan L function, coefficients of the Ramanujan tau function. And this is an elliptic curve of conductor 37. So what you see is that you have these two regimes. You have the linear regime, the straight line, linearly increasing regime, and then the universal saturation. And at least for the elliptic curve, this is as far as our data would take us. At least for the elliptic curve, you see pretty convincingly that you don't have this linear increase. You have a saturation. And this saturation is at a universal level. It doesn't depend on the conductor or the degree. So at least this is indicative that there is this new, this phenomenon of two regimes.
Has the correction term in the pair correlation, which is
yes.
in the form factor, the pair
yes.
been checked numerically? This, what you're saying is that this right. which is pair
yes. right.
is log,
yes.
which and is the standard thing.
And then there's a correction.
There's a correction term. Is that verified convincingly?
Not by us. I've not seen that verified convincingly. No, it's an idea.
So
yeah, right. absolutely. Yeah, no, it's a good suggestion. Okay, those are the slides I wanted to show, thank you. What I'll do for the last minute is just say that there's another reason that one might want to believe this kind of expression. And this is that you do see exactly the same phenomenon in function fields. So I see I only have a minute or two. So here we don't have a sort of formulae that are anywhere near as general as those are presented, because we don't have sort of equidistribution results in that level of generality, as far as I understand it. So what we did was look at some examples, and we do have a wide class of examples of degree 2 L functions defined over function fields where we can establish equidistribution using the techniques that Nick Katz has developed. So we can prove something unconditionally and where the results do match this sort of two regime behavior. So I'll just sketch this very briefly. This is the work that I've been doing with Chris Hall and Edva Roditi-Gershon. So just to sketch this, we're going to look at some polynomials defined over FQ, and we look at some elliptic curve defined over FQ of T. And we'll take an example of the Legendre curve, which is the analog of some elliptic curve. So this has some formula, some model, like y squared is x times x minus 1 times x minus t. We can generalize this substantially to essentially any function f here, which is square free, which is square free. So this is just I just want to write something concrete down. And then we have a set of conductors, S of FQ. So this is the set of admissible conductors, and these are going to be polynomials Q in FQ of T, which are square free. And which satisfy Q of 0 is 0, and Q of 1 is not 0. So the crucial thing is that they're square free. That's important for them to behave as good conductors. And second, for our analysis to go through, we need them to have a 0 in common with this polynomial here, which they have at x is 0, but not at x is 1. So associated with this curve, the sum L function, I think I'm beyond my time, so I'll just sketch briefly. The sum L function, and we can look at the coefficients of L prime over L and compute the variance of the coefficients of the logarithmic derivative of the L function associated with this curve. If we twist it with respect to characters, and we can establish some equidistribution result. And that implies, on similar lines of the calculation that I did with Zev Rednick, that implies some expression for something, a variance formula, which is the exact analog of the variance we've been calculating over here. An equidistribution implies that this variance is given exactly as some matrix integral, which we can compute, and we get the expression that the variance which is the analog of this variance we've been calculating in the number field setting, is just the minimum of n and twice the degree of q minus 1. So the calculation I did with Zev, which was for degree 1 L functions, misses this second regime. When you go to degree 2, what you recover is this second regime, and this is the analog of the constant regime, the second regime over here. And this we can establish for reasons that are best known to Chris Hall and not myself, provided the degree of Q is greater than or equal to 37. Nick, you might be able to explain to me why 37. Chris has had a very good stab at that, but I don't claim to understand whether that's a really essential condition or something that's just convenient for establishing equidistribution. But anyway, we can establish the analog of this formula for this class of curves, for this curve, twists of this curve. Yes. Exactly, yeah. And we can do that in more generality for Jacobian of hyperelliptic curves, where this is some more general form, modulo some conditions. So I'm sorry to have gone slightly over time. Thanks.